I'm Brian Hiatt. This is Rolling Stone Music Now. So we have back Brittany Spanos and Rob Sheffield. Welcome.
Welcome. Happy tortured poets. Happy new era.
The long day.
The longest day. We are the tortured by poets department.
But yes, we thought, we knew for quite some time that we were going to gather here today to discuss the tortured poets department, the long since announced new album by Taylor Swift. What we did not know is, yes, we were going to be discussing Tortured Poets Department, but in fact, it's Tortured Poets Department, the anthology, and it's a double album, a fact that Taylor Swift so kindly revealed to us at 2 a.m. after Rob had already written a review of part one. And no one knew, including you. No, it was an insanely closely kept secret. It foiled leakers. It caused so much sleep deprivation, I would bet, across the country that it might actually have a demonstrable effect on the sort of worldwide economy today. But yeah, there's two albums. There's so much to talk about. Most broadly, I would start by saying we did an anticipation episode. Our guesses for the sound of this thing, I think we kind of settled on, it'll be kind of like a mix of Midnights with Folklore and Evermore and a little bit more introspective, but essentially in that vein. And that's it, right? That's basically it with some. And then so many of the theories about what the songs were about and everything else wildly wrong. And some of it was just overthinking by fans, overthinking by us from the title. Many of these songs are not about the person that people thought this whole album would be about.
I will say, I don't think it was even overthinking. Like, I think we weren't overthinking enough, maybe. We thought there was an obvious answer of who the songs would be about, which was fair because she exited a 6-year relationship. She had written many albums about this love. And I think maybe we just weren't thinking hard enough on what else had happened last year.
I'm sure it occurred to none of us that, like, current high-profile boyfriend would get one song and 6-year boyfriend would get one song. And the rest of it would be about somebody that, like, Brittany and I were talking about, that I, for one, had totally retconned out of the story. I forgot that ever happened.
I didn't think it was possible for there to be so many songs about what was, 6 weeks of a relationship, of a public relationship? But yeah, I was very shocked. I could not believe that this was the tone of the album.
Honestly, Brittany, if anybody had seen it coming, it would have been you.
I knew there would be some songs, but I think the minute that I got to the title track, I was like, oh, this album is not what I thought it was. This is about someone, a different figure from last year than I anticipated. And I've loved all the other albums about him, and I hope to listen to many more albums about him.
So break down the other ones. There's Halsey.
Halsey wrote a lot of great Tumblr poetry about Maddie Healy as well, but her first album is about him. And I guess not all of it, but definitely the song Colors. And then FKA Twigs, Capri Songs, there's several songs on it that are rumored to be about him because they were still in a relationship at the time that she released it. A lot of love songs. So this was her first release since her big breakup album. And this was when she was dating Maddie and she released this very loving dance album about him. And now we're back to Breakup Zone, the natural pattern of things.
The Patty Boyd of ill-advised rebounds.
Yeah.
Like, he's the muse for that specific move.
The new Joe Jonas having an unlikely group of women band together and write songs about him that are immortal.
But your point about Joe Jonas is so 100% brilliant. Like, that is, because you were on the Joe Jonas secret history of pop music for anybody.
I was writing about him until Folklore. The songs were there. But yeah, even I was talking with a few of our colleagues today and I was like, it's interesting because I feel like a lot of her, obviously so much of it, she's like, tries to veil the details with, especially the breakup songs, right? Like, she tries to, like, at least keep it a little bit of a mystery. Obviously, there are songs that are a little bit less mysterious, but it is actually very, and there's still some mysterious tracks, which obviously we'll get into over the course of this. I can't really tell timeline-wise her life where it's from, but for the most part, it's like shocking, like how very direct she is about the influence and the exact inspiration and muse for a lot of these songs. It is very, very, like, I don't know. It almost makes like Style and Dear John seem like huge mysteries.
Yes, exactly. All the clues, like, oh, the title alludes to a Joe Alwyn group text thing, total, not even red herring. It was just a coincidence. I think it had nothing, not the single, not the slightest thing to do with anything. The other thing that was wildly off was the overthinking of "But Daddy, I Love Him" being a quote from Little Mermaid, which was a cute idea, but it turns out it's also just a cliche phrase that she plays with. And it turns out that doesn't have a damn thing to do with the Little Mermaid. Rob, as you said, it's really interesting in the fact it is wildly confessional. As she becomes more famous and more iconic, she's pushing back by, in the other way, by confessing the realities of her life, by digging into the sort of weirder, non-focus group, very potentially off-putting real aspects of her personality that she's willing to put out there. She's responding to the mega fame by just going back and making real uncompromised art, which that's the least surprising thing of all, because that's what she's always going to do.
Totally. I think, I mean, so many bait and switch moves here. It makes, honestly, it makes Reputation look like a softball straight down the middle of the plate. Like, as Brittany said, that all the excitement over the album title and the connection to that group text, which could not have been just more of a just flat out bait and switch. But also for me, and it might be just me, I thought from the song titles, which are so funny, that this was going to be a really funny, nasty sort of breakup album. And that,
yes,
so many funny song titles. I Can Fix Him. No, Really, I Can. My Boy Only Breaks His Favorite Toys. So Long, London, But Daddy, I Love Him. Thought that this was going to be a super dishy, catty breakup album. And instead, these are mostly very serious songs. I mean, they've all got funny lines, but the misery is not played for laughs.
It also, it been an album eviscerating Joe Alwyn, I think it might have sat weirdly. I think she's so much more famous than him. He now seems sort of this shrunken former presence in the pop culture. Had she really done that, I think it might have raised questions of like, wow, this is the most famous person in the world just spent a whole album just savaging this increasingly unknown guy. This is a little weird. And so I think this is much more, it's much more interesting.
Yeah. I think also, I feel like You're Losing Me was probably enough of a statement from her on it. Like, that is a very direct song about just falling out of love and feeling like you're working really hard at a relationship that someone has given up on. And that's just what happens.
You're losing me, star. You're losing me. I can't find a pulse.
And I think everyone, in the way that we all were doing, like everyone does this with any sort of celebrity relationship and things like that, where it's like you're trying to piece together like what the big drama was. I mean, just celebrity relationships, like any relationship where you're like, something big must have happened to have ended this like long romance. And sometimes it's just the truth is sadder, and that it's just like there's not a lot of answers. And I think that's what she addresses in the songs that seem to be more clearly about the relationship, like So Long London, and just the fact that there was no big apparent, like, again, some of the songs are a little bit more mysterious in who the actual subject matter is, but it does seem like the actual kind of long-term relationship that everyone's anticipating she would eviscerate and break down and give this like all these like crazy truths to just ended because they fell out of love, which is fair and what happens. But I think people were expecting that high drama, and it was a situationship that brought the drama, which is often the truth, which is extremely fair.
And I think it wasn't just You're Losing Me, right? It was actually, I think it now becomes, I was thinking about reevaluating Midnights as a whole in the wake of this. Now, I think we've suggested, and a lot of people suggest, that perhaps some of that, these are different midnights at different points in my life, it was a little bit of obfuscation of what the album at least partly was really about, which it, part of it was like the leading up to the breakup album. For example, Bejeweled. Okay, sure, it might have been about some other relationship too, but it sure does seem to speak to a lot of maybe some of the issues with that relationship.
Best believe I'm still bejeweled. When I walk in the room, I can still make the whole place shimmer.
It definitely connects to a lot of songs on the album, including also like even just like the timeline that both Jack and Aaron have given that Taylor has not given, which is Jack talking about this is the exact date when we wrote You're Losing Me, which was what, like 2022 or something when they wrote it, and like December 2022 or something. And Aaron Dessner is like, we've been working on this album for 2 years. I think adds a lot more that maybe Midnights has different meanings than we first thought. Oh, and also to the point you were saying about Joe Alwyn being, I don't know, like it would feel almost like punching below the belt with Joe. I think like Maddie is like a kind of a perfect subject matter in this because he is himself a songwriter, which is obviously in the songs kind of part of the appeal in a lot of the relationship, but also like no one has talked more shit about Maddie Healy than Maddie Healy himself in his own songs. And so it's like, honestly, there's truly nothing she can say on this album that is worse than a 1975 song.
That's true. And that's such an important point. Like, say what you like about her. She generally doesn't punch down. Like, she learned her lesson from Better Than Revenge, which specifically is she picks on targets when she picks on targets her own size. And It would have been a very different Vertigo after Joe Alwyn, who is definitively not in the game, whereas Maddie Healy, who who is in the game as a public figure. It's like The Wire. It's like you're in the game or you're out of the game. You don't shoot somebody's grandmother while she's on her way to church. You're in the game or you're out of the game. And Maddie Healy is definitely in the bitchy celebrity spectacle game. So yeah. It's all fair play.
It did occur to me, though, that the harshest blow of all to a like 6-year relationship is to clearly demonstrate that you are much more fired up about this much shorter relationship that came after it. It's almost more devastating than like a triple album of diss songs, the harshest blow of all. And to casually refer to said relationship as the slammer also is also. So it's not like he gets off unscathed, and not to mention the track 5, which we'll get to. It's really interesting. I think musically, and it's tough because there is this whole other second album to talk about. I think when people have come with mixed reviews of this album, they've come with two things. They challenge some of the lyrics, and I find most of the challenges to be silly. They're picking lyrics that are meant to be funny or meant to be colloquial or pretending not to understand lyrics that obviously anyone can tell what they mean. So I don't buy those criticisms. The other criticism that I've seen is people are saying that the music is too similar to what she's been doing, that she's in this groove and hasn't really broken out of it. I'll let the two of you respond to that. For me, I think after this, I would go for something closer to a reset. I'm not in charge. But for me, this wasn't too much more of that. I think there's enough room to maneuver within this Sonic universe, within versions of the Sonic universe she's created for the past couple albums, that there is room to move within it. But I think that's at least a rational critique rather than these lyric nitpicks. But I'm curious what the two of you think about the musical side of things.
This isn't my favorite Jack production. And I'm like a Jack apologist. I love a lot of his production work, and I think they work really well together, especially like on those songs like Clara Bow and was it So High School and I Look in People's Windows, like those songs that just sounded so different than what we usually hear from her, especially on the last few albums. Like I feel like those moments I was like, wow, I like would love to hear her kind of like dig into like weirder production and sounds, which I think is maybe part of the reason why she's still testing out with like the 3 a.m. 2 a.m. editions of like these songs, these like other parts of an album that are a little bit different than like the pop star Taylor that she still obviously wants to present and is still such a big part of like the Eras tour and like part of the total package. But I'm ready for her full-on experimental era. I'm ready for her to like dig into it because I think those moments are the ones that really stood out
to me. And this is based on absolutely nothing except just how the songs sound to me. It sounds more like the second half might have been songs that she recorded before Eras tour, but the first half definitely seems post Eras tour to me. And I think it's that one of the weird things about Eras tour was when she wrote those songs for Folklore and Evermore, she never thought she was going to be playing them live. Her shows had been canceled, the pandemic had started, and she didn't think she was going to be playing those songs in arenas or stadiums. So that's why she went as quiet and intimate as she did. That's why those albums came out as great as they did. She wasn't aiming for the big scale. I think it probably surprised her, along with everyone else, how huge those songs were in a stadium setting on Eras tour. And to me, the first half of the album sounds like she's wondering, what if I wrote songs at that level of detail and really just wrote Folklore Evermore type songs, but gave them that studio sort of push right from the get-go? And Jack Antonoff is definitely a producer who can deliver that. A song like Champagne Problems or Tis the Damn Season or Marjorie, for crying out loud, it was shocking how massive those songs could be in that setting. To me, the first half of the album sounds like, what if I just gave those songs that kind of grandeur in the studio? So I understand how the production can be off-putting for people, but I love it. And I love the very specific, the bombast of it. Bombast is a loaded word, but that's clearly like what she wanted to do and what Antonoff wanted to do. So it's these really intimate songs, but played with a kind of arena synth rock sort of dimension.
Brittany, with Fortnite, there's like a crazy preview of something we're going to be dealing with going forward, which is I've never had the thing before of hearing a real song after hearing a totally fake AI hook that really, again, was good. Really was pretty good. Someone with some talent.
Yeah, someone needs to release that because that was actually like a very good, for an AI hook, I was a little shaken.
The lyrics were super stupid, but the melody was good of the. But yeah. Anyway, I've never had a fake fucking version of a song in my head before I heard the real version.
I love you. It's ruining my life. I love you.
It really messes with you.
Yeah.
It's and I'm afraid this is how the world's going to be from now on. You know, it's just an awful, bizarre thing. But like every time when she gets to the real chorus, I'm like, wait, isn't it supposed to be awful? I feel bad about this. It's not my fault. TikTok threw it at me. I never sought it out. But anyway, so
it's funny because I had a very similar experience with the Alchemy, with that AI song that you both blew my mind with, the one that Travi made it to the game.
And happy that my Travi made
it to the big game. Listening to the Alchemy, I was like, this sounds almost like she heard that AI and said, yeah, fuck yeah, I gotta do that.
She is so happy her Travi made it to the big game.
She's like, why did I let GPT come up with this? I gotta go with this. I wouldn't be at all surprised if she heard that and she said, why don't I just do this as a real song? So when I touch down, call the
amateurs and cut them from the team. I think, first of all, I will say Posty, man of the hour, apparently. But I think his
pop girl's fave guy there.
Not judging one album against the other, but just judging the Posty songs, I do like this one better, I have to say.
I wanted more Post on it. I wanted just slightly more Post, but I do really like them together. I like the pairing.
By Snow on the Beach standards, it's a lot of Post.
Yeah, I'm glad we get a lot of Florence on that collab. But I also was like, I wouldn't mind like a little bit more Post on this. But yeah, I do like the pairing of them on the song.
It's funny. I think it's the one song in the album where she says, okay, people are expecting a comedy record, not a comedy record, but like people are expecting more of a flippant, frivolous kiss-off kind of album. And so this, I think, is the one where she's going for that, the way she just drops that, I love you, it's ruining my life. And the way she just put so many lines in the song. I think this one and Who's Afraid of Little Old Me are the ones where she was maybe going with that concept before she changed her mind. And she was like, no, let's just be sad.
Yeah, I love that. I love you, it's ruining my lifeline so much. And also the reference to Hits Different in the first couple lines. Great callback.
I don't know. I'm not hugely knowledgeable about Post's music other than the hits. So for me, this was I got to go back and get back to Post school because I just didn't know he was capable of stuff like this on someone else's record.
Posty is like one of those weird cases where he's like a billion albums in and yet seems like a total work in progress.
And the best decision he made was to start singing because he does have like a really lovely singing voice. And I think that like, I do not like his rap songs at all or rap albums. Like, I think they're very bad. But like, when I heard Chemicals, I was like, oh, like, I love his singing voice. And like, this is really fun. And he's like, actually like really charming at this. And so I've definitely grown very fond of him in the last few years, especially once he started to sing. And I think that was like the best move he's made.
It's fascinatingly slow, Fortnite. It's like 80 BPM or something. It's like super slow ballad pace, but it's not exactly a ballad. It creates this like dreamy thing to it. So it's a character situation. And when she says I was a functioning alcoholic, that's not Taylor.
I don't think that's Taylor. This is me trying, which was so using alcoholism as a metaphor. If she's an example of a functioning alcoholic, I'm opening a fucking bottle right now. I was like, wow, functioning alcoholics are totally lapping the field. The idea of Taylor being a functioning alcoholic is just funny. It's like the story about Abraham Lincoln talking about General Grant and people complaining about his drinking. And Abraham Lincoln says, I'm going to send all my other generals the kind of whiskey that he drinks. Like, we could all make 3 albums a year if we were functioning alcoholics.
I love that Florida is a weirdly central theme in this song that leads into the song Florida.
Yes.
Just that concept of Florida on this album is just so funny to me. I love the preoccupation with Florida. I wondered if
they were connected, like the folklore songs that are connected. I actually wonder whether the narrative continues.
It does feel like very like foreshadowing at the beginning of like a musical or something.
Maybe since we did the Post song, we could skip ahead to the Florence song. Florida.
This is actually my absolute favorite song on the album.
Awesome.
I've been listening to it nonstop. I'm a big Florence and the Machine fan. I'm like number one stan of the album Dance Fever, which was criminally underrated by people. That album should have been up for like 10 Grammys. It should have swept at the Grammys. It should have been number one on the charts. Like, I think that's like a perfect album. And that was an album where Florence worked with Jack. This is like a perfect storm, if you will, between Florence and Taylor that feels like very Dance Fever-y mixed with kind of like, obviously, the very like Midnights meets like folkmore sound that Taylor has on the album. I love it. I just love that it's about Florida. I love the line, "Fuck me up, Florida." I'm very excited to scream along to this in cars for rest of my life. And I love Florence dancing with ghosts on a song. It's one of my favorite things that she does on a song. And I'm just obsessed with the song. I think it just sounds so good. That like big drum chorus is amazing. And I was reading like Taylor's description of it for the iHeartRadio takeover that she's doing. And she talked about how she just like watches a lot of Dateline and just thinks about the fact that people always escape to Florida when they do something wrong. I love that as a theme for the song. And I think they sound great together. I'm like, I need a like Wash the Throne, Florence the Machine and Taylor Swift moment.
There's also a mention of Texas as well. Multiple mentions of Texas on this album. You possibly could, it might be a stretch, but there's the Quiet Treason on track one on Fortnite. You possibly could connect the narrative to she kills the husband and then goes to Florida. I wouldn't completely rule that out. That's the narrative, but I don't know. Perhaps not. Destin is so specific though.
Yeah.
What is Destin? Is there something iconic about Destin? I had to look it up.
A beach town known for its plentiful fishing. Challenging golf courses, mouth-watering seafood restaurants, and incredible golf views. So,
thank you, Brian. Google AI.
Yes, exactly. Maybe it's a Jimmy Buffett thing.
Maybe she's in her parrot head era, and we just have to accept it. But also, technically, from the Eras Tour point of view, chronologically, because I love the timelines, she played in Arlington and then Tampa on the tour, and I believe Tampa was the first shows after the breakup was announced.
Wow. Okay.
Because that's when she changed from Invisible String to the One.
A damn good change, if I may say.
I'm gonna write out a timeline. Please. I've been piecing it together all day in group chats.
I can't wait.
Alternatively, Rob, I'm gonna connect it with she heard Key West Philosopher Pirate off of Bob Dylan's Rough and Rowdy Ways and decided to write her own Florida song.
Brian,
everyone take a drink.
Yes, everyone take a drink. Brian, I could not be happier that you are the one to bring that up, because I have been living with this shameful secret that I keep thinking about that song. Also, take another drink, but I keep thinking about the Dylan song on the Traveling Wilburys album, Tweeter and the Monkey Man, which is another like do something evil and escape to Florida kind of song. Like, as you said, it's the role Florida plays is the place you
wait at the about. End they go from New Jersey to Florida. I don't even remember that part.
I'm going down to Florida. I'm gonna get me some sun. There ain't no action around here. Everything's been done. Sometimes I think about Tweeter, sometimes I think of Jane.
There we go.
Sometimes I don't think about nothing but the Monkey Man. The Bob Dylan Florida connection is very fascinating. Brian, we're depending on you to come through with the Springsteen Florida reference.
Tweeter and the Monkey Man is notoriously, of course, is a vicious Springsteen parody. So we don't even need to.
I do want to do a quick fact check for what I said earlier. She actually changed from Invisible String to the One in Texas, the shitstorm back in Texas, and then breakup announced before Tampa. Wow.
But yes, probably my single favorite musical moment on the album is that like little burst of like stadium rock burst in the chorus of Florida.
It's so good. It's honestly like I had high expectations for this song because, again, I love Florence the Machine and I'm hoping more people will listen to Dance Fever as they should. It went above and beyond the entire collaboration.
I have to say, I came into this, honestly, it made me shamed how shocked I was by how great Florence is in this song and made me realize even more so than the Post song that I really need to catch up. And Brittany, thank you for being my tutor into the Florence canon that I, like so many people, have shamefully under-focused on until now.
Everyone get into it.
I think it's about to be a Florence moment. There's an amazing scene at the end of Guardians of the Galaxy 3 set to the Florence and the Machine song, Dog Days Are Over, the most famous one, but it was an incredible, incredible moving scene. And then she's doing a Broadway musical. So I think it's, you know, it's everything's coming up Florence.
Right. She's doing the Gatsby musical.
But I will say it's like a rift in the Taylor universe, the fact that a guest singer is allowed to say the hurricane with my name.
Yeah.
Like another consciousness has intruded upon the lyrics in a way that's like freaky. It's just weird to have the guest acknowledging that they're the guest and referring to their name. Melted my brain a little bit, but it just felt like a canon violation for Taylor somehow. But she makes the rules.
I also, there's a lot of really great meta moments on the album that I love, but I especially love the Florence line where she says, "And in my mind, they sing it to the swamp. Is that a bad thing to say in a song?" Good. Love that moment. All the bodies that have ever been on my body, and in my mind, they sink into the swamp. Is that a bad thing to say in a song? Mm. So good.
She's so good on this song. And honestly, like, it was mind blowing how good she is on this song.
Is this the best Taylor duet track ever? This is
it's high for me. I think it might end up overtaking because I'm such a Florence stan, though Coney Island is still there. But those are probably, it ranks very high for me right now.
Exile's pretty high.
Yeah.
But this has a collaboration where like Florence is like doing her own very marked lines. You could theoretically like Coney Island and Exile are two of my faves. This one, the Florence is such an active narrator and you said referring to herself specifically. It's really different kind of duet than done for the most part.
Lana's like, I need a do-over. Like, come on.
Imagine Lana hearing this saying, she got a hurricane in her song. I did not get one flake of snow or one grain of sand on that beach. And she gets a natural tropical storm.
I will say I do hear Lana all over this album. There's moments when she's singing.
Lana influence.
The vocals especially. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Weird. Like there's a few moments where I was like, whoa, you sound just like Lana there. You sound more like Lana than you do yourself.
A lot of Lana.
Has Lana had a parrot head face?
I think she's probably been in one for longer than we'll ever know. She just like dropped a song tomorrow called Margaritaville where she just explains how she and Jimmy Buffett had like a decade long affair. I'd be like, makes sense.
Yeah. No one would be so shocked. Yeah.
She'd be like,
yeah.
Ride was about him.
Meanwhile, Jimmy Buffett was writing songs about her. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know it's
but she hasn't been born
fault.
Yet.
He predicted Lana.
He predicted Lana.
Yeah. Lana has strong parrot head energy.
Absolutely. And what a Taylor song Margaritaville is. Some people claim that there's a Maddie to blame or a Joe to blame, but I know it's my own damn fault. That could come straight from this album.
She should have been drunk up there with Paul McCartney at the Jimmy Buffett tribute concert that happened.
Like Florida has not begun to fuck them up yet. Yes.
What I was going to say is one of the things that's really interesting is the way different songs on this album reflect entirely different points of view on the same relationship. Clearly written, reflecting her own mindset at different points. The Smallest Man Who Ever Lived completely deconstructs what other songs previously on the album were saying about the same person. It was like, no, me from a month before was totally wrong. This is where I'm at. So that's interesting. That's definitely an interesting thing.
It's giving situationship psychosis. It's a canon event and I don't blame her and it makes sense.
So if I may go to track two, the title track, and this is where the album reveals itself, that it's not about Joe Alwyn, that when you're listening for the first time, this is when you realize you're in a very different place.
You're not Dylan Thomas, I'm not Patti Smith, this ain't the Chelsea Hotel, we're modern idiots.
And Rob, you compare it to an earlier Taylor song.
Yes, the White Horse connection. When she says this, I looked you in the eyes and laughed and said, you're not Dylan Thomas, I'm not Patti Smith, this ain't the Chelsea Hotel. It's very similar to a great song from Fearless, White Horse, where she says, I'm not a princess, this ain't a fairy tale, this ain't Hollywood, this is a small town. And a very common move for her to make, but especially on this particular album, is taking these teenage songs, these very girlish songs that she wrote about these really young girl fantasies and updating them for the really jaded and disillusioned adult woman in the city. She's always done a lot of that. Coney Island is definitely a song in that mode. But the idea of her rewriting White Horse, so it's about the adult version of that narrator from White Horse 15 years later, and she's in New York City and going through the same stuff with the same genre of dude, except now they're arguing over whether it's authentically Chelsea Hotel-esque or not. I just thought that was great. And of course, that was before I realized, hey, Dylan Thomas famously drank himself to death in his favorite bar in New York, which was the White Horse Tavern. That's her level with this album. Just think, this song is phenomenal. This is one of the highlights for me. The part where she sings about him taking her ring off at dinner and putting it on the wedding ring finger and her heart exploding, and just what an amazing out of nowhere kind of scene.
The deep revelations of the album begin there. You're like, wait, this is when you learn, oh my God, this short thing was this tumultuous, gigantic, heart-shattering situation, and you have to reevaluate both what you know about her life and what this album is going to be. And of course, it includes the line that really bugged people, that to me I found totally charming. You smoked, then ate 7 bars of chocolate. We declared Charlie Puth should be a bigger artist. I scratch your head, you fall asleep like a tattooed golden retriever. I don't know why that bugged people so much. It's bribing a domestic
session. It is her Charlie Puth stand-up.
That's right. Charlie Puth is happy. Listeners should be happy at the very, very detailed description. And that's once you learn he's tattooed, you realize it can't be the guy you thought it was. That's an important detail.
When I openly gasped listening to this album was the minute I clocked that lyric and I was like, oh no. Right. I think I had gone into this album thinking is wrong. Yeah. I love the song. I think that chorus is so good. I actually wish this was the lead single. I feel like that chorus chorus is so catchy. I've had it stuck in my head since the first time I heard it. And yeah, and like also any Patti Smith reference in a love.
Completely amazing. Also, an artist that Taylor has never explicitly name-checked before, which is surprising, giving her reverence for the 70s queens. And Brittany, I'm sure like a lot of people who know you, Brittany, I heard that line and instantly thought of you. I thought, oh my gosh. That was even before I heard Florida. I said, this is the Brittany targeting moment on this album. Taylor singing about Patti Smith.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's shout-outs to, direct shout-outs to Patti Smith, to Stevie Nicks, both her and Beyonce.
Starting line.
Yeah, both her and Beyonce.
Blue Nile.
Yeah, and Blue Nile is just to confirm once again who we're talking about, I think. It's just like the guy who stole that song.
Yeah. Blue Nile was where it tipped me off. Up to that point, I was still like, these don't sound like Joe references in these songs. And I wasn't even thinking Matty Healy. And then the Blue Nile thing came out of nowhere, and I was like, okay.
Also, Lucy Dacus gets a shout-out on this one.
Yes.
I can't imagine that it would be a different Lucy, especially in this context.
Well, you know what's interesting, right? So it's pretty unusual for her to, I think wildly unusual for her to drop real names like that in the middle of a song. And I think the Charlie Puth and the chocolate stuff is part of what this song is, which is very unadorned reality and truth. There's absolutely, that's all there. People, it's just amazing. Like even at this level, people act like she's some kind of idiot. Like it's like how about thinking about for 1 second, why are those very plain spoken things in there? You smoked and ate 7 bars of chocolate. We declared Charlie Puth should be a mega artist. Is it that she doesn't know what she's doing? Or is there something specific about this song where it's much more diaristic and completely undisguised? And I think clearly it's the latter.
It's also so Phoebe Bridgers too. Mm-hmm. Like the influenced becomes the influence on her music. And I think like it does feel, again, like she's often avoided the directness just out of like protection and like not wanting to distract from, especially in her younger years, like from the actual song writing themselves. And I think she has a lot more leeway now. And again, the person that she's singing about is a songwriter himself who also does this. But yeah, I think such a fun thing to see her be so like hyper referential to people in her life on the songs outside of like her mom or like a couple of her very best friends. Like it's fun to see her kind of play with that on the songs a lot more.
And by the way, again, we don't want to get too deep into like gossip and the details, but I do wonder whether the actual length of the relationship, there's obviously more to it than the public knows. That's clear from this album.
So we'll talk about Guilty as Sin.
Yeah, there's much more to it. And there's the fact that they had obviously dated before. Like they had a brief fling before, so there was history. I say this as to make it all more rational for people who are like, why is she going out with this guy that for all I know she went out with for a fortnight? And that's not the case. It's a little bit more than that.
Yeah, like they knew each other like a decade ago, maybe dated, maybe didn't, but at least had something like a decade ago. And clearly there was a lot of history leading up to it.
Oh, and to my earlier point, that sort of the omission can be the harshest thing on the previous relationship. The closest I've come to my heart exploding is when this other guy put a ring on her finger. That's also like by omission or whatever is like extremely devastating to the other guy. I have to point out.
Yeah. It's not the album anybody would imagine somebody making about them 6 years after 6 years together. You would think like this guy she barely knows did this little trick at dinner in front of her friends just to embarrass her. And it was so intense, but that's, like you said.
But yeah, the Dylan Thomas, Patti Smith, Chelsea Hotel imagery, I love because it's just very fresh for her. It's not imagery you would stereotypically expect from Taylor. And so it's like everything about the song is actually really different, really different. Like I said, it's actually really unique and just stunningly confessional about her feelings and about Maddie's feelings. And just like, it's like, it holds up a challenge to herself to keep up that level of unsparing honesty, which it actually is, particularly even though it's another songwriter, not Patti Smith. It reminds me of Joni, like Kris Kristofferson would tell her, leave something for yourself after hearing this song, right?
Yeah, it's a very Joni song. Honestly, this song is definitely one of my tippity top from the album. I think this is absolutely phenomenal, defining song on this album. It's one of her best title songs ever. And she has a way with title songs. Her title songs tend to be really good on the albums they're from. But I think this is up there with Fearless and Red and Evermore and Lover, the bangers.
My Boy Only Breaks My Favorite Toys is relatively slight lyrically, so it didn't make a huge impression on me at first. But I actually think it's musically one of the catchiest songs on the album. That chorus has been stuck in my head.
Breaks his favorite toys. This might come up later when we talk about Little Old Me, which is like a, when we talk about the like funny, flippant, almost borderline throwaway ones.
Speaking of unexpected imagery for Taylor Swift down bad track 4, if you polled me at the beginning of the year and said which artist was going to use an extraterrestrial abduction metaphor for Sex and Romance, Taylor would not have been at the top of my list. I was surprised and amused.
I'm down bad crying at the gym. Everything comes out, teenage petulance. Fuck it if I can't have him.
I love the chorus. Fuck it if I can't have him is an absolutely great kind of hook.
Yeah. No, I love this chorus. This and Torture Poets Department are my two favorite kind of like big, catchy kind of pop choruses. Or like, I don't even like big, but like just like really great stuck in my head hooks.
I just realized that if you listen to this song and imagine it's Elliot singing it from E.T., it becomes like a lot funnier.
Brian, I've never attempted this with any of her songs. I guess I got to go back and
turn on your heartlight. But it's the best. It's the most wrenching song about E.T. since Turn on Your Heartlight. How about that? Although I guess E.T. didn't experiment on anyone. He just wanted to mess with plants. He didn't do anything to people. But yeah.
There is something very X-Files about the aliens, alien abduction and dissection.
Obviously, it's a slightly lighter take on it. And it was also actually, that's as a songwriting exercise, I'm thinking a lot because that's what we do here. When you look at much of this album as a songwriting exercise, it's like two things. Like how many different songs can you write about this one emotion? And then how many different songs can you write about the different places, as I said, within this relationship that reflect different emotions. This is this sort of fun metaphoric version of the breakup moment in that particular thing. And it's like this relationship was so different for her that it felt like she was with an alien who then disappeared. So that's totally works as a metaphor, even if it's like a little funny. At the end, she's waving at the down bad, waving at the ship. Come back. Yeah.
I love that. Also, just the image of somebody who's like too bummed out to get out of bed is just, it's funny because that's honestly not really how we think of Taylor. We think of Taylor is being like, they're at the gym 10 minutes before it opens, saying, come on, let's get going. It's just very funny to think of her trying on the persona of somebody who just like lies in bed all day, bummed out.
I think she means like lies in bed for 20 extra minutes of the, it's her equivalent of the Christmas lights in January.
I hit the snooze alarm today and I'm not ashamed to say it.
I think it's that. Oh man, that brings us to the song that just incredible, like an incredible track 5.
Tragedy, so.
Fantastic song that serves the place of like the whole album that could have been just a great farewell song. It's this great elegiac, really genuinely beautiful song about the end of a relationship that really has a really beautiful musical lift to it. It's just a really powerful song.
Yeah, she's been writing about London since Red. Like she's written so many great songs about London. And obviously the song that's seen on the track list was already, I think, the song that a lot of people were most scared to listen to. Like, I think it was just like already teasing something very devastating, and it really, really lives up to that. So it's a very, I love the song. It is like a very devastating song from her. And yeah, again, like I keep bringing up You're Losing Me. I think that's probably one of my favorite songs by her. And obviously a thematic kind of, this is like a very much a part two to that song.
For you, how does it stack up to Come Back, Be Here?
Ooh, Come Back, Be Here is early 20s. Like it's very much like this is a decade difference. And also Come Back, Be Here has that early relationship, wow, I wish she was here instead of elsewhere type of a very specific kind of puppy love devastation. Whereas this is like things are really over after such a long time. Very intense kind of. Yeah. And again, those themes of like trying to hold on to something that really isn't sticking and really isn't like able to maintain. Yeah, it's a tough one. But I do really love this one.
It feels like the Come Back, Be Here London when I was expecting the London Boy London. Honestly, yeah. This is the one I was expecting to be one of the funny songs. I saw the title and I thought, yeah, this is going to be a really catty, really dishy sort of sequel to London Boy. Like, no, I don't fancy you anymore. Hackney wasn't that much fun. Like Camden Market was a drag. Who cares about Stepney? I thought it was going to be more when of the flippant sort of songs, and instead it's a real heart wrencher, and it's really the first moment on the album where you sit up and think, oh, okay, Aaron Dessner did show up for these sessions. Like he is on this album. And so it's just a really just an ambush in so many ways, especially after the songs that it's just followed.
The line that everyone's pointing to is, and I'm pissed off you let me give you all that youth for free for so long. And yikes.
Yeah.
Ouch.
It's funny because she's sang about this kind of thing before, like Cornelia Street, where she's like, wow, what if we broke up? I wouldn't be able to have our neighborhood in New York anymore. I wouldn't be able to go down that street. I wouldn't be able to use that coffee shop. And she's probably walking fine down Cornelius Street these days.
I think people took the line, you sacrificed us to the gods of your bluest days, to suggest he was depressed. He gave into his depression. He wouldn't fight for her. As angry as some of it is, it's more in sorrow than in anger.
There are so many songs on this album and so many like very specific lines that kind of link to other songs. So many of the ring references people put together with paper rings, songs like that. It's like these like little moments that connect this with like other songs in her discography and like obviously the CPR with the heartbeat and You're Losing Me and things like that. I love those little moments on this song that sort of are connecting that, kind of the use of colors and the way that she talked about their love on Lover and songs like Daylight and things like that. I really appreciate it on there.
It's a great Dessner moment. It's a bigger Dessner moment. It actually is a perfect example of what you were saying, Rob, is taking Folklore Evermore and making it bigger on record is like literally exactly what this song is doing. It's even the same, the producer you'd associate with that.
Totally. And also, since we're worrying so conscientiously about Joe Alwyn's feelings,
are we?
How he's being treated and not treated on this album, this is the song that you do want somebody to write when they break up with you after 6 years. This is how you would think about how they would write the song of the relationship after it ends. And there's honestly a lot of just tenderness and kindness in this song that is very powerful, I think. Reminds me, sorry to name check a deep cut from the debut, but this one reminds me of Stay Beautiful, which is a song she wrote when she was probably 14 or 15. But there's an element of kindness with the regret in this song that I think just makes it more powerful.
I love But Daddy, I Love Him. I think it's really great. I think it's a great chorus. Yeah. I think it's the whole song is that's I think there's definitely an element of this album where she wants the world to know that as much as we think we know her, we don't. That there's parts of her that we don't understand at all yet. And I feel like this song has some of that in it.
It definitely has that like 80s Don Henley feel, almost an end of the innocence type arrangement. The way the drum machine goes and everything. Running with my dress unbuttoned, screaming, but
daddy, I love him, I'm having baby. Yeah, this feels very 90s country to me, which I love. There's a little bit of the essence of Cowboy Take Me Away on it. It's just like the smallest hint of it in just the aura of Cowboy Take Me Away. But yeah, it feels very 90s country. And I think like what's interesting about this album, obviously Reputation is so much billed as like the kind of rebellious quote unquote bad girl turn for Taylor. But I actually find a lot of what she says on this album and like what she does in this album to be like true Taylor like rebellion moments. And her being someone who very much is not the type of person to tell the general public to piss off. It's a very rare moment for her to have a song where she's like, actually, please leave me alone. Do not tell me what to do to the general public, not just like a direct person, like as she's had like very specific people have that she's gone after in that way. But like, it is more so than ever her being like, please stop telling me how to like who I should date. You're wrong.
Someone was like, what does this mean? It's so vague. Sanctimoniously performing soliloquies I'll never see. It means the people recording TikToks tell her who to date. That's what that means. I mean, not like a hard to understand. It's not subtle at all. That's what she's talking about.
Yeah, but just, a lot of bad faith. And like, this is a pretty on the nose song. Brittany, your connection to 90s country is so brilliant. And that's such an amazing point. It really is very Dixie Chicks. It's very Trisha Yearwood. There's a real she's in love with the boy vibe to it. Such a theme of 90s country songs is they tried to tear us apart, but true love went out, which has always been a theme of country music, but especially in the 90s country female stars that Taylor grew up idolizing. It's absolutely brilliant.
A little hint of Independence Day.
Yeah, totally.
Just like the essence of it. It's not a full country song, but you can hear it in the guitar a little bit.
Yes, she absolutely. And she even brings back the accent a little bit.
Yeah. There's a couple of songs where she brings back the accent, actually, where I was a little like, okay, she's definitely recording debut.
But what she's
doing. She's totally. You're so right. This is absolutely the giveaway. She was recording debut
she's
the day she
tried it out
this.
Again. She's just trying to reintroduce us to it.
This is definitely like, it's late in your mama don't know song.
Yes, to unpack this, what Rob and Brittany are saying is that it appears that she was, it's a very smart thesis that she may have been finally recording the Taylor's version of her debut, and some of the inflections and songwriting could have instilled itself into this. I think that's super smart. What's so smart about this song is the thing she does elsewhere in the album and has done elsewhere in her career is it's doing two things at once. It's telling very explicitly a tale of something that happened to her last year, but also painting it in this small town drama clothing, right? Yeah. You're not painting in clothing, like dressing it in this small town drama clothing. So you could see it both ways. But it's definitely about people telling her that she shouldn't have been dating Maddie Healy. But at the same time, it has a fictional guise upon it. But it's really incredibly pointed. I'll tell you something about my good name. It's mine alone to disgrace. I don't cater to all these vipers dressed in Ampass clothing. I mean, you know, it's one of the most like fuck you songs she's ever written.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think what she's done, like think of like a song like Shake It Off or something, or The Man, in those ways that are about, that are her hinting at the anger at the general public. Like it ends up, she shifts them into like more of like an empowerment anthem. So it is very funny to get her be so direct this time and so just pissed off about it.
Also, the Scott Swift content is A++++. Her father-daughter storylines do not have father doesn't like my boyfriend. That is a genre of like of father-daughter plot lines she does not get into. Usually the problem is he likes the boyfriend too much. That's usually what drives him crazy. Last kiss, like yeah. She really liked his handshake when meeting her father. And of course, All Too Well, he's charming her dad like he's a guest on a talk show. And that's usually what bugs her about her boyfriend's response to her boyfriend. So it's really funny that this is really rare example of her going for the really might be the first time since Love Story. Like, my daddy hates him, but I love him anyway. Like,
yes, it's the careless man's careful. It's the careless man's careful daughter coming careless for one moment.
It's the careful dad's careless daughter, and it's a very unusual kind of plot line for her. I salute it.
Screaming, daddy, I love him, I'm having his baby. No, I'm not, but you should see your face. It's just so great.
And I will mention, since Brittany and I are here, like that line definitely does remind one of another pop star who has another like, I'm having your baby, it's none of your business kind of song, who has been on more than one occasion been spotted in public wearing a t-shirt that has the words on it, but daddy, I love him.
Interesting connection you've made there, Rob.
I just randomly picked, I seem to recall somebody wearing that t-shirt an awful lot for a few years around the time that he was in stadium singing.
Fascinating connection.
Totally random. Yeah. Totally random. Synchronicity is a weird thing. Yes.
Yes. So number 7, Fresh Out the Slammer.
Fresh out the slammer, I know who my first call will be to.
I think there's a Chris Rock joke about the Fresh Out the Slammer concept, that something about like your girlfriend knows exactly who she's going to call, something like that. So I think it's just proving that joke correct, clearly.
This is one of the ones that just hasn't really clicked for me yet.
Yeah, I do hate the turn of phrase, Fresh Out the Slammer. It takes me out when we get to it on the chorus every single time. But the sentiment behind the song, do enjoy. There's something like very like melodically nice about it, but the phrase always takes me out. And I knew it when I saw the track list. I was like, I'm already, the title of the song has already lost me. So it was not working.
It's one of two songs, again, guilty of sin, where she admits she was thinking about the one guy while she was still with the other guy. So, which is, again, like she's not hesitating with the confessions on this one.
Yeah, the lore is crazy. I will say, as someone who's at the intersection of 1975 fan and Swifty, it has been an insane day online just for the content of the lore. Any interaction they've had since 2014, I have not fully processed this yet. Like, it feels like I feel insane having heard all these songs and now having to piece together just an entirely different universe that I didn't know existed.
Right. Yeah, no, it's...
Or didn't know was so... I didn't realize the universe was so expansive in that way. My mind's still reeling.
Or the connection... Or the importance of this connection, obviously.
Yeah. Like, it was just... I was like, oh, she was... It was just... It was a rebound. And I didn't realize there was years and years of potential kind of, like, interest on both sides.
Clearly. And guilty of sin, yes. In a similar vein, again, this is where we have Drown in the Blue Nile, He Sent Me Downtown Lights. I know that the 1975 basically borrowed that song for what, Love It If We Made It or whatever. I don't know much about Blue Nile at all, but I have a feeling you do, Rob.
This was a gasp out loud moment for me. This was also the oh my gosh, Maddie Healy moment on this album.
Yes.
This was basically the scene on The Sopranos where you see the waiter's bow tie at dinner and you're like, oh my God, the waiter is a cop wearing a camera. Like, it was that kind of gasp out loud. It was Hal 9000 reading lips, basically. The Blue Nile, I was like, wait a minute. Like, and that absolutely like took me to the Maddie Healy thing that was obvious there all the time. But Blue Nile, 80s Anglophile cult band's cult band. They were A Walk Across the Rooftops is their most canonical album, but Hats from 1989 is also a banger. And that's the one that Matty Healy and his band love most and stole the most from. The idea of her just casually dropping like, yeah, somebody sent me this song by the Blue Nile. I hadn't heard it in a while. I hadn't heard it in a while? Like, that's a pretty deep cut to be throwing into a song like this, and completely blew my mind. Definitely not a conversation. I was definitely not planning to have about 10,000 conversations this week about the Blue Nile with like friends of mine who stopped listening to music in 1992. But that's the way she works. Like, Blue Nile fans all over the world are having a real Destin, Florida moment right now.
They should have a Taylor Fest in Destin, Florida with Blue Nile playing. Actually, I don't know if Blue Nile is like alive. I have no idea. Yes,
I'm sure Clarabeau's family would show up. And so would Charlie Puth. He'd probably play. Like,
yeah,
he can headline above Blue Nile. Yes. It's one of her most libidinous songs, I guess I would say. It's pretty clear what it's about. It's really something.
You heard way. Getaway Car.
Sure.
You
know? Yes. No, it's true. Yeah. Getaway Car from the Slammer. Yes.
Oh my God. I never thought of that. If she went to the Slammer for Getaway Car, she'd be just getting out now.
Yeah. The song, this was the second loud gasp, no, third loud gasp of the album, both the Blue Nile reference and just everything she's singing about on this. Again, the timeline in my head has, it's broken my brain.
That's funny. The timeline in my head, it's broken my brain, sounds like a lyric from this album, actually. So
Taylor, yeah. You can take that. Put that on the whatever.
I'm thinking of Tom Waits singing Downtown Train. I don't know. But so, who's afraid of little old me?
And last an hour in the asylum where they raised me.
In which Monster on a Hill makes a return, you could say, or some version thereof, which she's levitating and shit. It's very much in the vein of But Daddy, I Love Him, but the even darker. I don't know how you can take the dark side of that song, but she's found that it's the even darker. Again, it's exactly, I said, there's an element of like almost songwriting exercise in that. She takes, it's exactly the same subject matter as yeah. Daddy, I Love Him, but a whole different take on it.
The song feels very like My Tears Ricochet meets Mad Woman for me. As well. Like, I wow. feel like there's such a combination of that sort of like anger on it, I guess. Like, and also just like at the, I don't know, just like at the way people talk about her in that But Daddy, I Love Him sense, but sonically reminds me a lot of those two songs. But yeah, I do really love the, I guess it's, yeah, I guess it's technically the bridge. That whole portion is great. I wasn't like totally sold on the song until I got to the bridge.
Great bridge. I love this song. It's totally like, sorry to like go for another 70s rock reference, but this is very much like a Alice Cooper, No More Mr. Nice Guy. Mm. kind of song. Mm-hmm. And specifically, one of my favorite lines on the album was, I was so tame and gentle until the circus life made me mean.
Yeah.
That's such a phenomenal line. By the circus life, she might mean being in the relationship. She might mean just like
showbiz,
being a woman in the public mm-hmm. eye. Yeah. But might be also like the feeling of being on display. But that's such a powerful line. And of course, to me, it makes me associate the song with Mirrorball. And this mm-hmm. song is almost the like angry, really pissed off elder sister of Mirrorball. It's like, I've been on the trapeze trying to get you to notice me, and it's just made me mean and nasty and harsh. And I love that. The whole thing of like, you know, you kids wouldn't last one day in the asylum where they raised me. It's just, the rage in this song is really amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm always drunk on my own tears. Isn't that what they all said? That I'll sue you if you step on my lawn, that I'm fearsome and I'm wretched and I'm wrong. Put narcotics into all of my songs, and that's why you're still singing along. I said that, But Daddy, I Love Him is her most fuck you song ever. That is until you get to track 10, and then it's this song.
Totally. But like, your connection to the anti-hero is so brilliant, because this is like yeah. anti-hero minus the desire to make it charming.
Minus the hero.
Yeah. She's like just flat out heel turn. She's like, what if all this was true, but also let me add, I don't like you. I hate doing these tricks for you. Like, this is, it's in some ways the flip side of I Can Do It with a Broken Heart.
Yeah.
Where she's like, even when I'm in a good mood, I hate playing this role for you. And on some level, it's about showbiz and celebrity, but also part of it makes me think it's about just various types of adulthood and feeling yeah. like your life has been taken away from you, which is a very common feeling for people in their 30s.
Yeah. And I think also there's this sense across like a lot of the songs, especially maybe why the particular relationship that she focuses on is such a major focus, is the continued sort of fascination with deconstructing the good girl element of her own image and how that plays out and how that sort of like traps her in a lot of ways. Obviously, that's like becomes a big part of Clara Bow, and this song in particular as well. A lot of the lines seem to hint at that obsession with kind of the pristineness of her image still and the presentation of it, and but still how that sort of has trapped her and, I don't know, has made her relationship with the public very complicated.
She told us the old tower was dead like 7 years ago and we still and no one really bought it. And part of this album is like, she's like, I really meant it. I think that actually is part of this album. And yeah.
Let me take out all the troubling subtlety for you.
She's fucking dead. Like what am I supposed to do here?
Dead. Here's her grave. I love the cobwebs so much. It's weird how much that one word in this song jumps out for me.
Yeah.
She doesn't have enough cobwebs in her song when, in retrospect, there should be cobwebs. A lot of Taylor songs could be summed up as cobweb mode, but this one, I just love this. And another song where she's fantasizing about being a really like bitter, angry, tough, mean old lady.
I can fix him. No, really, I can. Smaller song, again with the Texas reference.
The dopamine races through his brain on a 6-lane Texas highway.
Brittany, I'm so glad you clarified the timeline. That really helps me understand the Texas on this album.
Yeah, the Texas-Florida connection. Amazing. And the one.
Absolutely. This is one of the great song titles on this album.
Yeah.
And there's some good ones.
This sort of like vaguely Western Chris Whitley setting is unusual for her musically. Definitely the first Taylor song I can think of where it referenced Chris Whitley. I don't imagine that came up in the studio, but it does have a little bit of that.
Yeah.
So track 12, L-O-M-L, Love of My Life, but it also, in the closing twist, suggests it might be Loss of My Life.
In the nick of time.
Another devastating banger. Yeah, this one is another top favorite. Like, I think it's just like so gorgeous. Just like obviously very pared down piano ballad for it. But yeah, I think it's again, like with sort of the framework that we now have of the album and the subject matter of it, like even then, two of the most devastating tracks on it are very clearly about this long-term relationship and the end of it and reflecting on it. And I think that's obviously very pointed in between some sillier tracks from Taylor, some lighter pop fare from her. But yeah, this one is also very devastating.
And then this is where she talks about that I can't get out of bed. And again, with the rings and talking cradles. And by the way, on this album, it seems like she wants that 1950s shit also. Maybe she protested too much last time.
Protested too much, yes. But honestly, Brittany, you've mentioned You're Losing Me a lot. Wouldn't Marry Me Either. I thought of that constantly while listening to this album, yeah. Especially in this song.
Which is one of her most devastating lyrics, I think.
Yeah.
Ever. Yeah.
That's always a gasp out loud lyric.
Yeah. And also even the line that really gagged me on this one was, Mr. Steal Your Girl, Then Make Her Cry, really got me on this one. It was like crazy.
I love I Can Do It With a Broken Heart.
So
with music that's like somewhere between LCD Sound System and Men Without Hats, somewhere between there.
But it is the first Depeche Mode album.
There we go.
And Jack Antonoff is often very much admirably and eloquently talked about Vince Clarke as one of the great architects of modern. He said a few years ago that everybody in pop music should collaborate on a check for $1 billion to Vince Clarke because everybody's just ripping off what he did in 1982. Yeah. And this is a great Vince Clarke love letter among the many other things it is. He started with Depeche Mode, did Yaz, and then Erasure, a legend to this day, and really just very beautiful, very explicit sort of tribute.
Yeah.
And this is another, there's like a lot of sort of retcons, rewrites of what we thought we knew. And this is the one where she reveals the whole time at some point in the Eras tour, when she seems so triumphant and happy, she was miserable. And that's super interesting too. I presume that's what it's about, at least.
Yeah. No, I feel.
Sure. Seems like all the pieces of me shattered as the crowd was chanting more. I would assume. Yeah.
Do people still call this in the 90s? It was called compartmentalizing.
Yeah, sure.
Is that okay? I don't know if that's a word that people still use, but
yeah,
it's funny because like the way she describes it in this song, honestly, nobody hears this song and says, wow, I guess the Eras tour, like she wasn't into it. It's like, no, yes, she was into it, but just like the way that, like she said, she can't do it with a broken heart.
With the chorus, I did feel, I'm not saying it's deliberate, but the I'm so depressed to act like it's my birthday every day bit, it's like her outdoing Olivia at Olivia's thing a little bit. I did feel that. It could be an Olivia hook, but it's really good. and it's not wildly out of that vein, just saying.
It is a very like Gen Z sentiment.
Yes, yeah. And even the sonics of it, it's going to become a TikTok trend. It's just like very... Yeah.
It's going to be a million Instagram captions for people's... I'm going to probably use it.
I think this is the big hit. This is the big pop hit from this album, I think.
Yeah,
I think.
It's like Bejeweled's very depressed younger sister. It's depressed Gen Z sister.
Perfect. Yeah, it's a very likable song. Very cool.
Yeah.
Brian, I love your comparison to Olivia. So are you implying that she's her father's daughter, so maybe she can fix him?
Track 14, as we've been hinting, is where she starts reevaluating the whole thing.
If rusting my sparkling summer was the goal, and I don't miss what we had.
The perspective shifts wildly, and she's singing about the same guy, and all of a sudden she realizes that he's a piece of shit. That's what it's about.
Yeah. This one, yeah, I didn't quite like it the first couple times I listened to it, and then I've grown a fan of it. I do like the Jehovah's Witness suit line, but yeah, this one is, again, a lot of kind of covert anger, or not covert anger.
not super covert.
Not covert.
Yeah.
That's her idea of covert.
Yeah.
The Jehovah's Witnesses thing, that sent me like on a very fruitless sort of search. I honestly don't know what she's referring to, but
she's referring to those. I think the consensus is those like goofy black suits that Matt Healy wears on stage. Yeah. The bridge is not, it reads like a joke, but it like you hear it like a joke. But I think the paranoia is real. Were you sent by someone who wanted me dead? Did you see underneath her bed? Were you writing a book? Were you a sleeper cell spy? I really do think that some of that paranoia is somewhat real. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. That has been a recurring theme. Like the idea of like people wanting her dead on this album and the last few.
Yeah, no, she just said, if you wanted me dead, you should have said so. Yeah, no, like on a couple of tracks earlier, yeah.
Yeah.
She's taking us to him at her funeral, like, dead to you, why are you at the wake? Like, she loves this kind of theme. But honestly, she doesn't have other breakup songs that sound like this one. This is, I think, the angriest, like, most spiteful one she's ever done. I have to confess, it even made me ask Brittany if there was a chance that this was maybe about another ex from maybe, like, say, 14 or 15 years ago.
I had already pieced together all the evidence.
I'm so glad you did. Really? You eased my mind about that, because I thought, there's only one person that she's even come close to singing this way about. And even then, she didn't say he belonged in prison.
But also indicates that she was ghosted and says that he deserves jail for ghosting, which I think is a very fair assessment of anyone who ghosts, is that they should go to jail. And she's right.
Absolutely. Maybe in 50 years, it'll be declassified. Maddie Healy was an inside job.
But yeah, and then the Alchemy, that's the song where she's so happy that her Travi won the big game.
So when I touch down, call the amateurs and cut them from the team. Ditch the clowns, get the crown.
Some people did wonder whether it's actually a red herring and it's like going back to the Maddie thing because of a couple things. Those blokes worm the benches, and then it's heroin, but this time with an E, which is weird. It does seem like that's not her current relationship, but yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
Otherwise,
it could be about everyone.
Sure.
I had a theory that this was like a song about multiple people for a brief minute, but I do think it's mostly Travis. But also, like, we'll have another episode where we talk about the second part of this album. But after hearing So High School, I'm like, why was this? You could have just... So High School is so much
yeah, it's
better.
It's a better song. Yeah.
It's so much better. Football better metaphors song. Are so much more fun on that one. And this one, I'm a little like, okay, this is someone who just learned what football is, much like me, and is using the exact words that they know that they can use in a sentence, again, much like me. So I can't judge her entirely for that. But I'm like, So High School is so much better of a song about this relationship. And I'm like, I could have cut this one and replaced it with So High School, which is a great song.
Great song. I love it. I have to say, I have a real soft spot for this one. I love that she's just discovered football imagery and just sports imagery in general. And just imagine the door that is being opened to her.
You know what? I think maybe let's leave that door shut.
At this point, she's singing about like touchdowns and trophies, but like, wait till she starts singing about third down conversions.
Let's not do that.
I thought we left the football team on team. Like,
yeah. Exactly.
Let's start quoting his tweet. Let's get to that.
You couldn't spell squirrel. You are my whole world. Just stuff like that. Yeah.
Listen,
they don't do spelling tests for the NFL. See, I almost said the NBA. I don't even know what's going on here.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, this is not comfortable territory for me either.
He knows ball and Aristotle.
Right.
Absolutely. Oh my God. Like you said, he's not a man of words. More power to him for like Not a man of words.
Yeah.
He's going to teach her all this football lingo that is going to be all over her next album. Like, just imagine, we're in the scrimmage zone. Scrimmage? See, I don't know football lingo. Yeah, either.
Kill me. But we have just enough time to talk about the amazing final track.
Thank God.
Yes. Clara Bow. Speaking of Olivia Rodrigo, you look like Taylor Swift in this light. We're loving you. You got Ed. She never did. The future's bright, dazzling. It's about Clara Bow. It's also about showbiz's hunger for the new. And it's all there.
I love the sound of the song, first off. The guitar on here is like incredible. And I'm obsessed with the song. This was like, took my breath away the first time I heard it. Yeah, also it's a song that references Stevie Nicks and has Taylor Swift talking in the third person. And that is an easy sell for me. That's really like, once you have Taylor Swift talking about Stevie Nicks on a song, I'm going to be like, this is the best song that's ever been written. But yeah, I love this one.
Yeah,
so
she was.
It just sounds, it's mesmerizing.
You look like Stevie Nicks in 7 Day 5.
She was saving this for a long time. She waited a long time to play this card. We've been just waiting for all these years, and it absolutely delivered. It could not be more amazing.
And also like this and a couple other songs, second part of the album, remind me a lot of Liz Phair, and something about the guitar in this one reminds me a lot of Guyville in a lot of ways.
The Desner stuff does help keep things fresh. Jack Antonoff is perfectly capable of doing guitar stuff too, but when it comes to Taylor, he seems to be mostly in the synth bag, and when she wants guitar, she goes to Desner, seems like.
Part of their beautiful synergy is that he's like, this is what I can do that Desner can't do. He's not going to do the Vince Clark tributes. Like, but for this song, like you said, the guitar in this song is just amazing, and it's a song that's a story that she's told many times before. Nothing New is probably the best and best known example, but she really makes it incredibly powerful and just a really beautiful full circle story for her.
Yeah, another great bridge. The idea of beauty is a beast that roars down on all fours, demanding more. And it's almost like the great God beauty here. That's what we're talking about. And do they let you know it's hell on earth to be heavenly? Them's the breaks, they don't come gently.
Yeah. Super interesting. And again, I think that is so much a thesis of a lot of the songs that, like I mentioned earlier, just like that good girl image is something that she talked about before. She talked about in the documentary where she mentioned this kind of obsession with being seen as good, with being good at what she does, with being seen as a good public figure, a good role model, all of those things, and like seeing a lot of that come to a head, especially over a relationship and several other things at once, as she was becoming more famous than anyone has ever been or should ever be in anything. It's like just a level of fame that's absurd. And I think especially that last, like the outro, referencing herself, referencing this idea of like these artists, a person or this kind of this collection of artists, I think it's more so referencing like a generation of artists that are inspired by her and are seen as edgier than her or are seen as having more of that easiness with not being seen as like super perfect or super heavenly. The way that she had to deal with is really powerful and pretty remarkable to see her commenting on.
She's got Edge, She Never Did is also an interesting commentary at the end of an album that's all Edge is also interesting, honestly. But yeah.
It's really that she does this and still doesn't make it feel at all like a song about showbiz. This doesn't at all sound like a song about a pop star who worries about being washed up. This is a song about somebody who's in their 30s and their life has dramatically changed and they're wondering if certain things are over and they're just reevaluating their life. And she makes this song, even though it's so self-referential, that she makes it relatable and universal. So relatable and so universal, but she doesn't make it feel like it's a song about a pop star.
Yeah.
Also, Brian, I love what you said earlier about talking on Reputation about the old Taylor is dead. Like, this is another one where she's like, look, I'll make this really easy for you. The old Taylor is just not coming to the phone.
We will return with part two of the Tortured Poets Department, the anthology. We didn't know it was an anthology, okay? We've only covered the department. We haven't gotten to the anthology part. We will return. But Rob and Brittany, thank you. The album's so epic, we couldn't even try to handle it in one episode. She really used her illusion on this one. What's so civil about war anyway? Is what Matt Healy is asking himself right now.
She's like, Matt Healy, get in the ring.
Perfect, perfect. I was going even deeper, going to the industrial track at the end. You got to step into my world. It's a socio-psychotic state of bliss.
Step into my world. It's a socio-psychotic state of bliss.
Oh, totally. Yes. God, I forgot about that one. Definitely used her illusion.
We will return. Rob and Brittany, as always, thank you so much. Rob has announced a book about Taylor Swift coming out when?
November 12th. Heartbreak is the National Anthem.
Indeed it is. Go pre-order it. Rob and Brittany, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And that's our show. We'll be back next week. In the meantime, subscribe to Rolling Stone Music now, wherever you get your podcasts. And please leave us 5 stars and a nice review on Apple Podcasts and Spotify, because that's always appreciated. But as always, thanks so much for listening, and we will see you next week.